We engineers like to come up with precise, clean, elegant solutions to our problems, don't we? We get out our spreadsheets and put in all our data and our constraints and our fancy formulas. But what happens when unexpected things go wrong? Well, we've also got some brute force go-to solutions like duct tape, hammers, and of course, the ultimate fix-it tool, the crowbar. But when is a crowbar not a crowbar? When it's AC line protection. Duh. Okay, maybe you aren't as versed in AC line protection as I am. Well, my friends, that's about to change right now. Hi, I'm Amelia Dalton, host of Chalk Talk. Providing robust AC line protection is a tough engineering challenge. Lightning and other unexpected events can wreak havoc with even the best engineered power supplies. Today, my guest is Pytlik from Littelfuse, and we're going to talk about the innovative technologies behind Littelfuse's SIDACtor semiconductor hybrid crowbar protection for AC power lines. And before we get started, don't forget to click that link. There you can find even more information about Littelfuse's SIDACtor crowbar protection. Hi, Pete. Thank you so much for joining me.
Hi, Amelia. It's very nice to be with you.
So we are here today to talk about hybrid crowbar AC power protection. But before we get into the details, Pete, tell me a little bit about what exactly we're going to cover today.
So Amelia, what we'll be covering today is a very innovative AC protection scheme involving SIDACtor protection components, along with an MOV and potentially a fuse. So we'll be covering the basic components, reasoning and solution introductions, how you select and calculate to determine what values you'll need to use, and then also we'll be covering some application scenarios.
So what kind of solutions does Littelfuse offer in this space?
So the solutions that we offer are clamping type solutions and crowbar solutions. In this particular presentation, we'll be addressing the SIDACtor, which is a crowbar component. The SIDACtors do come in different surge current ratings and also voltage ratings, and also a very broad selection of different types of packages. As we see from the IV curve, what are the characteristics of a SIDACtor? So the SIDACtor is a crowbar type of device. It does have a standoff voltage. And then it also has a switch voltage. Once the device switches, it goes into a crowbar state. In its crowbar state, the SIDACtor is at a very low voltage, which really gives it its true capability. Very low power dissipation while it is in a crowbar state.
Okay, so why are we talking about SIDACtor crowbar protection? What do you see are the main points of interest with this technology?
Amelia, some of the features and benefits of the SIDACtor are its high surge capability and its low on-state voltage. Also, low overshoot during high DVDT events. This is the rise time of a surge. Because this is a solid-state silicon component, there is no wear-out mechanisms. As long as the device is operated within its datasheet specs, there is an unlimited capability to this device. So we also have multiple standoff values, different voltages to choose from. And also, it can be used in a wide variety of different applications, from cable TV trunk amplifier network systems, outdoor LED lighting, switch mode power supplies, AC drives. Also as a replacement for other protection technologies, such as MOV TVS combinations or inductor TVS combinations.
So how does this compare with GDT?
So with the GDT combination with an MOV, because the GDT does need to turn on first, the GDT has a much higher turn-on voltage than a SIDACtor. So as you see from the schematic, the scope capture, the turn-on voltage is much higher than when using a SIDACtor with an MOV combination. And that could be actually significantly higher. So that is one of the benefits of many of using a SIDACtor in combination with the MOV versus a GDT with the MOV solution.
Okay, let's expand this a little bit. What are some other things to think about here?
Some of the other things to consider is when you're looking at the first turn on, in addition to having the much higher voltage at turn on, there's also some oscillation due to the characteristic and nature of GDT. The SIDACtor, being a solid state device, has a much more defined turn on characteristics as seen in the scope capture.
Okay, so how does SIDACtor compare with other solutions?
So looking at the IV characteristics of overvoltage protection devices, as we see in the IV curve, an ideal solution is one where you're standing off the entire voltage. Once the device turns on, you clamp at a very low level, as close as possible to the standoff voltage. But due to the inherent dynamic resistance of a TVS or MOV, that voltage will increase. The TVS and MOV are clamping type devices. The SIDACtor and GDT are crowbar devices. If we combine an MOV plus SIDACtor, as shown in the green IV curve characteristics, we can combine the capabilities of both, and you can actually stand off the entire voltage. You can use a much lower rated MOV along with the SIDACtor to stand off the voltage, which will result in a much lower overall clamping voltage. So the IV curve characteristic of the MOV and SIDACtor can now be shifted to the left. So you get the benefits of standing off the entire voltage using a much lower rated MOV, which will result in a much lower clamping voltage.
So Pete, what does this look like in the real world?
So protecting AC power lines, there are various, as we mentioned, different technologies available. So in this particular example, we're looking at an AC input, 220 volts, showing a schematic how the SIDACtor is placed in the circuit, and then what that actual scope capture looks like. In the first example, we have a SIDACtor, which is in parallel with the line, and also a fuse. What we're highlighting there is that the designer needs to be mindful that the fuse also needs to withstand the same current as the overvoltage protection device. In this case, again, a SIDACtor. Using this component by itself, parallel across the line, the designer also has to be mindful of follow-through currents, which is really determined by the voltage and impedance of the circuit. In the second example, we show, again, a SIDACtor in parallel, but now in fuse in series with the SIDACtor. The fuse, again, will need to survive, withstand the same surge current as the protection device, which is the SIDACtor. But we're also placing now a much smaller fuse, a lower I squared T fuse, which will have much better opening characteristics if there is a short circuit that occurs anywhere in the load. So we're comparing here two solutions and various protection schemes. And again, there are different types of topologies, and these are just a couple examples. And the exact placement of fuse, selection of the fuse, can vary from application to application. So here in this particular example, what we're showing is what an actual surge waveform looks like with just the SIDACtor. This is not a combo solution with an MOV. This is just highlighting a SIDACtor by itself. So what we're seeing in the left scope capture is when the SIDACtor turns on under a surge voltage. In this case, we'll refer to it as a 3000 amp 8x20 pulse, which is a very common current pulse for lightning-induced transients. So we can see that once the device turns on, it goes to a very low on state, a crowbar state. There will be some voltage, but is much lower than a clamping type device. In the second scope capture on the right, we're showing how the crowbar device, again, the SIDACtor, behaves under AC voltage when it is triggered. In this case, triggered at the 90 degree angle on the AC voltage, when the SIDACtor does crowbar, it will bring that line voltage down, but will reset at the zero crossing. In this particular example, the follow-through current is limited by a certain impedance in the circuit and is shown just as an example. What we're showing here is, again, what does it actually look like when a device turns on under an AC type waveform?
Great. Can we get into a little more depth about this solution?
Sure. So in this particular example, we're showing is an actual AC input, 220 volts, and we're highlighting the overcurrents and overvoltage protection scheme. The overvoltage protection scheme consists of an MOV in series with a SIDACtor. The overcurrent protection scheme is a fuse that precedes that. The selection of the MOV and SIDACtor is such that the series combination will stand off the entire voltage, the normal line voltage. But we're now selecting an MOV, which is much lower voltage than if an MOV was to be used by itself to stand off the entire line voltage. The benefit being of this combination, the SIDACtor plus MOV, is you're selecting a much lower voltage MOV, which in turn will give you a much lower clamp voltage. Also, you're significantly reducing the leakage current. If you're using an MOV by itself, the MOV does have a certain leakage current associated with it at the line voltage. So you're going significantly lower in the microamp range versus an MOV used by itself in the circuit. So how does this SIDACtor plus MOV in a circuit actually look like on a scope capture? So in this particular slide, we're highlighting the MOV plus SIDACtor solution and what the actual voltage and current through the combination, comparing with the 300 volt MOV by itself. The combination yields a much lower clamp voltage. The SIDACtor will first turn on, and then the MOV will clamp at a much lower voltage. Also, the SIDACtor and MOV combination will again yield a much lower leakage current than a standalone MOV.
So, Pete, do these solutions differ geographically or by market?
Yes, and also by voltage. So voltages seen AC inputs, 110 volts, 220 volts, but are not limited to those voltages. And the voltages can actually be much higher. And we do have solutions also available. We're highlighting here in this particular example, in North America, typical 110 volt AC inputs. For Europe, a 220 volt input, and some solutions with part numbers that could protect against both 3,000 amp 8x20 microsecond surges and also 5,000 amp microsecond surges. These are a specific example. Again, depending on the AND application, the circuit topology, the input voltage, the part numbers may vary and may need to be adjusted.
So if I'm looking for a solution in this space, what all should I be considering?
So selection criteria for overvoltage protection, in this case, a SIDACtor or a SIDACtor plus MOV combination, the first thing we want to do is define what is the max AC line voltage, the max current rating, and then also what is the surge level of the transient we're trying to protect against. So what we want to do is, if we're using a SIDACtor by itself, just the component in parallel across the line, we want to make sure that the standoff voltage of the SIDACtor is higher than the peak voltage of the line. We also want to be mindful of the max surge current, that the device is capable of handling that surge current. If we're combining an MOV plus a SIDACtor, the MOV voltage should be greater than the AC RMS voltage. But we can also choose an MOV which is much lower. But the designer does need to be mindful of the AC follow-through currents, that they are within the capability of the MOV and SIDACtor. And those follow-through currents will be impacted by the line resistance and also the MOV standoff voltage. We also want to make sure that we check the fuse rating and it is within the capability and has sufficient I2T to protect against the surge and also the end circuit that you're trying to protect, because the fuse also needs to withstand the same surge current as the overvoltage protection devices. So in a single SIDACtor application, again, we need to verify the SIDACtor plus fuse combination will be within the capability of the devices.
Okay, before we jump into the application areas, can you review how the SIDACtor compares with other protection technologies?
Sure. The different type of technologies that are currently offered on the market are most typically used are the GDT and SIDACtor, which are crowbar devices, MOVs and TVSs, which are clamping devices. The SIDACtor device is a solid-state crowbar device, has much more refined capability than a GDT. Much faster turn-on, very high power handling capability versus GDT. These components, again, are typically used on AC inputs, but combining SIDACtor type of technology with an MOV can yield a much lower and in many cases a superior clamping voltage in order to protect the circuit.
Okay, Pete, can you walk me through what an example application would look like?
Sure. So we'll highlight two different types of applications, but before we actually get into the application scenario, the typical surge standard, which these applications were tested under, and what we'll be referencing is the IEC 61000-4-5. In both of the scenarios, we will be testing and showing results from a 1 to 6 kV, a surge test. And what we'll be comparing is what the actual results are with and without SIDACtors, and also SIDACtor plus MOV protection schemes. In the first scenario, we'll compare the surge performance for a typical 15-watt auxiliary power supply. So in the second scenario, we'll compare the surge performance of a GaN-type AC charger.
Okay, so let's walk through those two scenarios you just mentioned. What about the 15-watt auxiliary power?
So for the 15-watt auxiliary power supply, which is actually a typical application for various types of auxiliary circuits, this type of power supply will require protection upfront from transients. So in this particular example, an MOV is used on the AC input. And because of the higher clamping voltage of the MOV by itself, the clamp voltage may be above what the withstand capability of the circuit you're trying to protect may be. By combining an MOV with a SIDACtor, we can stand off the entire AC input voltage, use a lower rated MOV, and in turn yield a much lower clamping voltage. Now, within the capability of the circuit that we're trying to protect. So it will be a much better solution combining the two protection technologies, again, the MOV and SIDACtor versus an MOV by itself.
So what do those results look like?
So with a single MOV, both the capacitor and MOSFET input voltage is much higher than when using a SIDACtor plus that lower rated MOV. So looking at the data, the clamp voltage at the bulk capacitor, comparing an MOV solution with an MOV plus SIDACtor solution, we can see going all the way up to a 6 kV surge transient that the voltage is much lower and within the capability of the 450 volt rated capacitor, which we would not have with an MOV used alone on the AC input. Also looking at the voltage across the MOSFET, again, the SIDACtor plus MOV yields a much lower clamping voltage within the capability, the rating of a MOSFET. The MOV solution, as we can see, by itself on the AC input would be above the capability of both the capacitor and the MOSFET. So by using these two components in series, in combination for the AC input, again, yielding a much lower clamp voltage and within the capability of the devices we're trying to protect.
Okay, Pete, so what do some actual results look like here?
So looking at some scope captures here under a 6 kV condition, we're highlighting here showing the voltages across the capacitors and also the MOSFETs. And again, we can see on the left scope capture with an MOV by itself used at the AC input that the voltages are higher above the capability of the circuit that we're trying to protect. In the right scope capture at that same 6 kV transient, we can see that the voltages are much lower, again, much lower than the MOV by itself, and within the capability and rating of the circuit that we're trying to protect. Again, in this particular example, within the capability, the voltage rating of the capacitor and MOSFET. We'd also like to highlight some additional results because not only by going with a SIDACtor plus MOV solution lowers that clamp voltage, but other component values will also have an effect. In this particular case, the inductance, common mode chokes, located on the AC input. So we also like to highlight, in this particular example, a NTC was used as an overcurrent protection device. So we also do need to be mindful of the effect and the characteristics and how that may affect the overall clamp voltages that are seen on the circuit. So in this particular example, using a 620 volt MOV, we can see that the clamp voltages at the bulk capacitor, much higher at 5 kV, because of the current through that NTC at that 5 kV level, we do see a failure. With the MOV plus SIDACtor solution going all the way to 6 kV, you get a lower clamp voltage, and also we're protecting that NTC from failure. Also on the MOV side, we're just again highlighting the voltages, and with the MOV plus SIDACtor solution, where again, within the capability of the capacitor, within the capability of the MOSFET, and also within the capability of the overcurrent protection NTC device.
So what about results here?
So looking at the actual scope captures, we can see that the MOV plus SIDACtor combination yields a much lower clamp voltage. In this case, we're looking at the right scope capture, much lower than the MOV scope capture on the left. Within the capability of both the capacitor and MOSFET, and also the overcurrent NTC protection device.
Okay, so what about that second scenario you mentioned, the 61 watt GaN power charger?
So in our second application example, we're highlighting the benefits of an MOV plus SIDACtor solution versus no protection at all. So again, we want to be within the damage threshold of the components that we're trying to protect.
Okay, so what kind of results can we expect to see here?
So looking at some actual results, the clamp voltage at the bulk capacitor with no MOV versus the results of a SIDACtor in combination with the MOV, we can see for the latter that the clamp voltage is much lower and we can withstand a much higher surge current. Also, looking at the results and the voltages across the MOSFET, the SIDACtor and MOV, again, yield a much lower clamp voltage than with no protection at the AC input. And you're within the capability of the bulk capacitor and the MOSFET.
So Pete, what do some actual results look like?
So looking at some actual scope captures, we're comparing the MOV plus SIDACtor solution to a AC input with no protection. You can see that the voltages across the capacitor and MOSFET get are much higher with no protection. By using an MOV plus SIDACtor solution, we can significantly reduce those voltages. And again, be within the capability and rating of the MOSFET and capacitor. We'd also like to highlight that in addition to the MOV plus SIDACtor protection input scheme, other components will also have an effect. In this particular case, we are looking at the input inductors, and we're comparing a 25 millihenry versus 76 millihenry inductance value. And as we can see here, by going with the higher inductance, we can significantly reduce the voltage rise time during the surge and also reduce the total length of the surge. So in this particular example, 76 millihenry in the left scope capture, we're highlighting what that voltage looks like on both the capacitor and MOSFET and how that time and voltage is reduced versus the 25 millihenry inductance.
So Pete, what are some current market design approaches that you've been seeing here?
So some of the current market design approaches involve MOVs, TVSs, SIDACtors, and various combinations, but also some involve paralleling several electrolytic capacitors. And just by using capacitors alone, that is not an ideal protection scheme. It has a very slow response to any type of fast surge inputs. Also, the higher voltage electrolytic caps can be expensive and bulky in size. Some designers like to enhance or increase the VDS or standoff of the MOSFET in order to survive that surge voltage. However, raising the standoff voltage of the MOSFET can be costly. By incorporating the MOV plus SIDACtor solution, in turn, because of the lower clamp voltage, that standoff voltage or VDS of the MOSFET can be reduced.
So Pete, what do you think are the biggest benefits of using a SIDACtor and MOV solution?
Some of the advantages of using a SIDACtor and MOV solution are: costs can be reduced by reducing the number of components in the protection scheme. Ultra low leakage, we can reduce that leakage current, improved reliability and robustness of the system, which in turn yield reduced product return and or claims.
Cool. Okay. So Pete, can you recap your main points for me?
Sure. So pure common mode choke plus capacitor, NTC or inductor in power lines and other various protection schemes may not, or in certain cases, cannot adequately protect switch mode power supplies or other types of AC inputs under various surge conditions, nor even under repeated surge conditions. To ensure the line capacitors, MOSFETs, or any other components are within the capability of the surge, the SIDACtor or SIDACtor plus MOV AC line protection is recommended to keep the surge voltage down to an acceptable level for both the MOSFET or capacitor.
All right. So if I'm ready to get started, what kind of support do you guys have for me?
Sure. So some of the solution support that we offer and we have available are demo kits, which include various protection components such as SIDACtors, MOVs, fuses. We also offer evaluation boards, which the designer can test out the protection scheme. We have a very comprehensive application note, and also we offer lab testing.
Excellent. Well, I'm going to click on that link and go to a mauser.com page for more information. Well, Pete, I think that's all I have time for today. Thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you, Amelia.
And before we go, you didn't forget to click that link, did you? There you can find even more information about Littelfuse's SIDACtor Crowbar Protection. For Chalk Talks, I'm Amelia Dalton from eejournal.com. For more Chalk Talks, head on over to the Chalk Talk section of EE Journal. You can't miss it. It's right across the top. Or head on over to YouTube, youtube.com/EEJournal.